tonight's Galileo Cafe, we're going to become marine biologists. And we're going to hear about the coral reefs and the probably what's threatening our precious coral reefs. As you know, the coral reefs are really important ecologically, but they're very important economically, too. And I think the Australian barrier reef is you can see that from a satellite, or if maybe, you know, if somebody's looking at our planet from some faraway galaxy, they might see this big thing in our planet. Actually, it's the only living animal that you can see from outer space on our planet, because these coral reefs are so cool. And even though they comprise maybe 0.1% of the coral reefs around the Earth, they have 25% of the marine ecosystem, so they're really special habitats. So our thought leader speaker for this session is internationally recognized, and she's recognized not just by scientists, but by other policy individuals and individuals in all sorts of government agencies who are involved in trying to get legislation passed or agreements with other countries, or at least awareness so that we can protect some of these precious economic resources that are, and ecological resources, excuse me, that are declining. And so imagine if you're a scientist and you're an environmentalist and you want to make a difference in this world, it's not just about doing some good research and publishing some cool papers or even writing some books. You gotta go out there like an activist. You gotta talk to other countries. You have to convince the politicians they have to care about this. And so that's what our fantastic speaker tonight does. Not only does she do her own research and make discoveries, but she teaches us students, and she gets involved in public policy to try to convince the world that they better do something about it before it's too late. So we're really excited to have her. She got her bachelor's degree from Rutgers, do I remember that right? And then her master's degree from William & Mary, and then her PhD from the University of Hawaii. That's a great place to learn about marine biology. And she's won the 2018 National Oceanographic Partnership Program Award for Excellence in Partnering, and the 2018 American Association for the Advancement of Science, Science and Technology Policy Fellowship. And she, there's a very long list of different things that she's done up on the Hill, but I think one of the most interesting things to me is the U.S. federal agency, the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Agreement, where she advised and coordinated U.S. policy across different branches of the government. So again, just to repeat, if you want to do something important in ecological science, you can't just stay in the lab. You got to go out and convince the leadership of the countries to do something about it. And that's what Jennifer does. So thank you very much, Jennifer.
Thank you for that very nice introduction, Dr. Liotta, and thank you all for coming tonight. It's wonderful to be here, especially the day before Earth Day, to talk about coral reef ecosystems with you. All right, so coral reefs, they are spectacular. Actually, that's a picture of me when I was working at the State Department in Papua New Guinea. Fantastic reef. So coral reefs are spectacular. They're full of color. They're teeming with life at all levels, from microscopic to macroscopic. In fact, they are so diverse, they're often referred to as the rainforest of the sea. And although they cover a small fraction of the ocean surface, they indeed harbor 25% of all marine life. And they do this because the coral reefs provide habitat, they provide shelter and protection for different fish species and invertebrates, a home, as some of the animals like these Christmas tree worms actually burrow and live inside the corals. They provide food. Many fish and invertebrates actually eat the coral polyps. And reefs are host to all sorts of interesting other invertebrates, like the stomatopod crustacean, and this reef octopus you can see blending in with the corals behind it, as well as many others. And with all of this diversity, all these diverse organisms on the reef, come many different interesting interactions and symbioses like this one you're probably familiar with, which is the sea anemone and the clownfish, right? So one provides food and the other provides protection. There are also other interesting symbioses like cleaning stations. Have any of you ever heard of these before? Oh, wonderful. So you have larger fish and turtles, they come cruising in onto the reef like a landing strip, at an airport, and you have wrasse and tang and other fish that come and pick off the parasites and dead skin. And the turtles and larger fish just sort of line up, get in line for this cleaning station. But indeed, the most important symbiosis on the reef is the one you can't really see. And it's the one between the corals and their single-celled photosynthetic microorganisms, their symbionts. These are dinoflagellates in the family Symbiodiniaceae. And before I get too far on this, we'll come back to this, I want to take a step back and talk about what a coral actually is. So some corals look like plants. Some can be mistaken for rocks or boulders. Some even kind of look like brains. But indeed, they are living organisms. They are in the phylum Cnidaria, and they're closely related to jellyfish and sea anemones. And in fact, if you take your hand and make a jellyfish, I'm your professor now, so I'm making you do this. You're doing this with me. Okay. And then you turn it upside down. You now have your tentacles with a mouth in the center. And now you have a coral polyp. And if you take this and shrink it down and cover a surface of a colony, you now have a coral. So corals are colonial organisms. You have many polyps interjoined. On the left here is a hard or stony coral. These are the reef-building corals. They have a calcium carbonate skeleton. On the right is a soft octocoral. And these are more leathery and soft. And actually, if the octocoral and hexacorals, you can count the little tentacles, and they have 6 and 8 respectively. That's how you can also tell them apart. So if you take one of those polyps and you cut it in half, you get your tentacles, right, surrounding your mouth, leading into the pharynx, or sort of the throat of the coral polyp, into the gastrovascular cavity, which is essentially sort of the stomach, okay? And so all of the polyps are actually interconnected through gastrovascular canals. They can share nutrition and food. And they also deposit this calcium carbonate skeleton. So the tissue layers that make up a coral, there are 3 tissue layers. The outer epidermis, the outer layer, has mucocytes that produce tons of mucus. And if you were to touch a coral, which you wouldn't, because we don't touch corals when we're diving or snorkeling, but if you were, they are very, very mucousy and snotty. This outer layer also contains what are called cnidocytes, which are stinging cells, the same type of stinging cells that jellyfish have. So they use those to capture small prey items like zooplankton and eat them, take them into the mouth. They also, in this inner layer, the gastrodermis, is where the symbionts are housed. And it's here that they fix carbon via photosynthesis and then pass this on to the host. In fact, 90% of the carbon they fix into sugars and carbohydrates is passed on to the host coral. The host, in turn, provides shelter, a safe place to live, so these microorganisms aren't floating around in the water column where they could get eaten up, right? And the host also provides metabolic wastes in the form of nitrogen and phosphorus to the coral, so sort of like almost fertilizer, right, for these photosynthetic organisms. It's also this symbiosis that aids the coral animal in laying down the crystal formation to lay down the skeleton. And in fact, if you were to cut a coral colony in half, like shown here, it's only the first several millimeters that are of the surface that are living tissue. The majority of the colony is actually the skeleton. So the coral living tissue will lay down some skeleton, lift up, lay down more as it grows, right, over the years. So if you're a boulder coral, you're gonna do that in sort of a circular formation. If you're a branching coral, which you'll see in a few slides, you're going to extend out from your tips. And so what you might also see here, though, is some coloration within the skeleton, this green coloration. These are ostreobium algae and other fungi, and they make up part of what's called the endolithic microbiome, which we don't know a lot about, but I'll come back to this later. But that's living in the skeleton separate from the coral. So it's indeed the endosymbionts that give the coral the most of its color. The coral tissue itself, this is a polyp with tentacles here, and you can see they're fairly translucent or clear. So it's the symbionts that give a lot of the coral coloration that you see. And so the light's able to penetrate, and they're able to perform photosynthesis. And in fact, corals thrive or prefer to live bound by 30 degrees north and south, generally, on either side of the equator, in warm, shallow, relatively warm, nutrient-poor waters with plenty of sunlight. And in fact, as you mentioned, they're so good at building these skeletal structures that they can build them so large that they can be seen from space via satellite. And this is indeed the Great Barrier Reef that you're speaking about, which is 2,300 kilometers long. And it's the whiteness of the coral skeleton that's reflected and picked up, and it's the lighter colors here is where the reef is located. But also mentioned, you essentially gave the introduction to my talk, so thank you. Oh. No, it's fantastic. Also mentioned is, you know, in spite of their intrinsic value and their beauty, coral reefs provide a lot of ecological goods and services to human populations, and they do have great economic value. So to start, they provide coastal protection. They're barriers that can buffer sort of wave energy, reduce wave energy and wave height to protect coasts, especially during storm and hurricane events. And many people around the world depend on coral reefs. Over 500 million people worldwide depend on them for food, income, and coastal protection. In the U.S. alone, they provide $375 billion worth of ecological goods and services. And many of these, for example, come from fisheries, tourism, and of course, coastal protection. The annual commercial value of reef-based recreational or fisheries is $100 million per year. And again, they provide millions of dollars worth of preventing flood damages due to storms. So they're really important, but as mentioned, they're very threatened as well. And in fact, we've lost over half of the world's coral reefs since 1950. And those are due to things like pollution, overfishing, coastal development, habitat degradation, and climate change. In fact, the Great Barrier Reef has lost greater than 50% of its corals since 1995 due to warmer seas driven by climate change. And as we speak, Australia's Great Barrier Reef is experiencing its sixth mass bleaching event. And what's even more worrying is that this is occurring during a La Nina year, which is traditionally cooler. And so now, as time has gone on, the sea surface temperatures have incrementally increased to the point where even a cooler La Nina year is too hot for these corals to persist and survive. So what happens when corals bleach is you get a breakdown in this symbiosis between the coral host and the dinoflagellates. It can be a result of numerous stressors, but typically when we see it, especially these mass events, it's due to increased sea surface temperature. So even just 1 to 2 degrees, excuse me, Celsius for a few weeks is enough to disrupt this symbiosis and cause bleaching. If the symbionts are not regained, the corals will die. As I mentioned, the majority of their nutrition comes from this symbiosis. And right now, this is the most serious threat to corals around the world. So this next video is showing in a cropped coral, and you can see it's losing its pigmentation because the symbionts are being expelled or leaving. We're not exactly quite sure of the exact mechanism, but there's still live tissue there and there's still polyps. So you can see the tissue becoming lighter due to loss of symbionts. And here it's newly bleached, so there's still tissue here. And in fact, you can see some refuge here from the irradiance and temperature, and this is still populated with symbionts and the underneath shady spots. And so if the heat stress is removed, either from just the temperature decreasing or maybe a storm will roll through or an upwelling event that will reduce the temperature, then these corals may be able to regain their symbionts, be repopulated, and survive. However, if that heat continues for an extended time, they will eventually die. And they'll go from this, looking like a healthy reef, to here, newly dead, to completely dead. And although this looks brown in coloration, it's not due to live coral tissue. It's actually due to microbial biofilms coming in and settling on this fresh, clean skeleton and growing and then recruiting other algae and cyanobacteria that then start to bioerode the skeleton and break it down and it becomes coral rubble. So when that happens, you're not only losing the live coral organisms themselves, but now you're starting to lose the habitat for all the fish and other invertebrates and diverse life that rely on those corals for a home and for food. So as I mentioned, The Great Barrier Reef is experiencing its sixth mass bleaching event. The first global event we noticed occurred in the late 1990s. And since that time, we've observed that coral bleaching events are increasing in severity and frequency. So I'll break down this graph from the Science publication in 2018. On the upper left here, you have years 1980 to 2016 and the number of locations bleaching over that time period. The black portion of the bar is severe bleaching, so over 30% of the corals bleaching, and moderate is less than 30. And you can see over time, we're seeing more of the severe bleaching. The next graph here is from, again, 1980 to 2016, and the number of unbleached locations over time is greatly decreasing to zero. So most reefs that have been observed around the world have experienced bleaching at this point. Conversely, here you see the cumulative number of events of total and severe bleaching have increased over time. This is looking at the number of locations and number of bleaching events, severe and total, but I want to fast forward to this graph that's looking at the return times. And so the number of records of bleaching, and what we're seeing is, again, a decrease in the time between mass bleaching events. So this is really significant in that it doesn't give the corals a chance to recover. And so over time, if you have numerous chronic disturbances, it will lead to ecosystem collapse. In fact, the latest status of the coral reefs of the World Report that came out in 2020 showed that over the decade period from 2009 to 2019, there was a 14% decline in corals that was primarily due to recurring large-scale coral bleaching events that prevented the coral cover from recovering. So not to go further down this sort of negative path, but unfortunately, bleaching isn't the only issue facing corals, especially in light of climate change and human impact and degraded ecosystems. We're also dealing with an increase in the prevalence of coral diseases. And this figure here shows just the number of diseases, from surveys from 1973, between 1973 and 2020. And you can see essentially all of the world's reefs are impacted by disease. And although there are many, this is just a selection. We don't know the pathogenic agents for most of these diseases. And for the ones that we do know a little bit about, it's usually bacterial associated. And that might just be because we have better methods to study bacteria versus virus or other abiotic causes of disease. So this disease here, black band disease, is probably the most well-known. We've been probably studying it for over 40 years now. And what's interesting about it is it's not just one particular microorganism that causes the disease. It's a consortium of microorganisms. It's first initiated by settlement of this cyanobacterium. And then you have sulfate-reducing anaerobic bacteria that come in and sulfate-oxidizing bacteria, mat-forming bacteria. And they form this black sort of bacterial mat that moves across the colony and sort of denudes the tissue. There are many others in which some bacteria have been assumed to play a role or shown to show a role. But the one I want to focus on now is this one called stony coral tissue loss disease. Have any of you heard of this disease? Okay. So this is what we think is a new disease. It's an emerging disease. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we know about it so far. So stony coral tissue loss disease was first reported in off the coast of Florida in the port of Miami in 2014. It affects over 30 coral species. This is quite significant in that there aren't that many diseases that impact that many different species. It spreads very quickly. It has a very rapid mortality and high mortality rate, and that complete mortality occurs in about 50% of affected colonies. It has a large geographic range. You can see from this graphic here that it, from 2014 to 2020, it spread throughout the Florida Reef Tract, including these marine protected areas. And in 2018, it started to pop up all around the rest of the Caribbean. So each point represents a different survey. The purple are still being confirmed. Green is they didn't find evidence of disease. And red is disease confirmed. So the good news is it hasn't made its way down here. Bad news is it started here, made its way. These were some of the last sort of outposts. And in 2020, it was observed in Honduras and Belize. So it's made its way across the Caribbean. So as I mentioned, it spreads or moves across the colony very quickly. This is just a 1 month period showing the progression of this disease across a colony of Pseudotaporia strigosa. So this again is the healthy portion of the colony. This is the disease lesion that's actively moving. So you get just tissue loss. It just sort of peels off the coral. And here you have 60% of the coral dead in just, you know, about a month's time. So some of the things we do know is not all species are impacted in the same way. Some are more highly susceptible, some are intermediately susceptible, and some have lower susceptibility. The unfortunate thing here is the ones that are have the asterisks, are listed under the U.S. Endangered Species Act. So they're already threatened, and so this is not good news for them. You can see here in this diagram some of a close-up of the different coral species, what an individual colony looks like, and then this is what they look like when they are showing signs of stony coral tissue loss disease. So as of now, there are hundreds of scientists working to try to determine the disease dynamics and identify the causative agent of this disease. So some of the things we do know is that disease signs can be transmitted in experimental aquaria when you either put a diseased fragment or colony next to a coral colony and they directly touch, but also if you put them in the same tank and they're not touching, so it appears to be waterborne. And in fact, there was an epidemiological survey conducted to see how this spread across the Caribbean. It didn't seem to follow the currents, but they think it might have been following movement of cruise ships and other vessels. And so there have been some studies to see if it could be transported in ballast water. As I mentioned, the pathogen has not yet been identified, but there are a few suspect bacteria and viruses that I'll talk about. So there have been several more recent publications looking at the microbes or microbiome associated with the disease versus apparently healthy corals. And there are a few overlap here in some of these rhodobacteriales and rhizobiales. And these are actually biofilm formers. They are early colonizers of biofilms. So we still don't really understand if these are the causative agent or if they're just opportunistic. And once the coral is sick, they kind of come in and start to metabolize the dead tissue, as we can see in other sort of opportunistic diseases. And then more recently, a research group conducted a study in which they found these filamentous viral particles infecting the dinoflagellate endosymbiont. So that's what these are. This is a transmission electron micrograph. It allows you to look inside a cell, so very close up. The main issue here is that this was found in both healthy, apparently healthy, and diseased corals. And this virus also is the morphology is very similar to other single-stranded viruses of plants. But as I mentioned, once again, it was found in both apparently healthy and diseased samples. And so one of the main caveats of studying wildlife disease, well, was first of all that corals can't tell you how they're feeling, but also that we don't really have a good assessment or idea of what a healthy animal looks like in the first place. We don't have a lot of baseline information. So that can be confounding, and we're really working hard to try to get that information. Okay, on top of that, the reasons we think there is some sort of bacterial component to this disease is practitioners, resource managers, first of all, some of them are going ahead of the disease front and actually removing healthy colonies from the reef and placing them in aquaria all across the country so that it could later be outplanted. This was a huge rescue effort, really dedicated individuals, were very time-consuming, costly. But the other thing that folks are doing is trying to find interventions. So they tried chlorinated paste, and that didn't work as well. They tried different antibiotics, and amoxicillin seemed to do the best, where it can abate the spread of the disease across the colony in many cases. But again, we don't know if that's because these microbes or these bacteria that we're finding are secondary infections, or if it is the actual cause of the disease. Also, very costly and time intensive to go and apply antibiotic paste to every colony on a reef, right? And also probably maybe not the best idea to put broad spectrum antibiotics into the environment due to the antibiotic resistance that might ensue. Finally, it could have nothing to do with a bacteria virus. This could be some stress response to abiotic factors that have not been identified yet. And so all of these folks, all these scientists are working really hard to try to determine what's going on here, because it has been very devastating to coral ecosystems and the communities that depend on them. So my laboratory, in conjunction with Dr. Esther Peters' laboratory, who's sitting here in the audience with us tonight, have been working together. And some of the previous work that Dr. Peters had done, she's a histopathologist, found that this disease seems to sort of manifest deep in the tissue where those symbionts are found, and that they start to degrade and die first, almost like they're being sort of eaten from the inside out. And so they had the idea that perhaps there's some role that this endolithic microbiome is playing. So if we got a few years of funding from the Florida Department of Environmental Protection to investigate these communities. We had numerous students working on these projects. Sam Cook from George Mason was performing histology to look at the condition of the endosymbionts in apparently healthy and diseased corals. We had another student, Murphy McDonald, from Nova Southeastern University at the time, who was looking at immunohistochemistry to try to distinguish whether there was necrosis versus programmed cell death, essentially like cell suicide as a stress response, if that was a component of the disease. And then we had another group of students, graduate students and undergraduate students, looking at the microbiome composition. So they were looking at the endolithic microbiome, bacteria, something called archaea that are similar to bacteria but genetically distinct, and actual fungi, which are often overlooked, especially in marine ecosystems, and are very hard to study because there's just not a lot known about them, but certainly they must play an important role. So in summary, this work is ongoing, but like some of the previous studies, we weren't able to find sort of like one bacterial smoking gun, so to say, right? We did see some of the same usual suspects in our samples found in other studies. But again, we had this issue where we are often seeing similar results in both apparently healthy and diseased, so it's ongoing. We are also somewhat limited by our sample size, so we've since worked to expand that and targeted our research from these preliminary data to try to better get at this question. So we're currently working with a team of scientists and practitioners from the Roatan Marine Park and the Roatan Institute for Marine Sciences. And then we have our Mason group, Dr. Tom Wood, who's also in the audience. Again, Dr. Peters and our graduate students. This is here, we're here on a sampling trip in Roatan. And for this project, we're actually trying to look at the effects of antibiotic treatment on stony coral tissue loss affected corals. So looking at both the impacts on the microbiome and also the corals themselves. So again, as I mentioned, we know that this antibiotic treatment seems to abate the spread of the disease across of a colony, but to date, there's been no in situ investigations of which microbes it's knocking out, right? So maybe we can get a better idea of what the pathogen or pathogens might be, or maybe what else it might be impacting at the cellular level of the coral or the microbes. And here is a picture of a dendrogyra coral. This is on the endangered species list. They're quite beautiful. Unfortunately, this one is affected with stony coral tissue loss disease. So the Marine Park folks had tagged it. They applied amoxicillin paste along the disease margin. And this looks like a new application, but hopefully that was holding and preventing the disease from spreading. So you can see the bare skeleton and still the live tissue there. So the idea of this is we are, and by we, it's really our hardworking partners from the Roatan Marine Park that live in the area that are going back and monitoring these corals and checking them every month. They're simply amazing. It's several young women, and it's just this small team of young scientists that are going on doing this single-handedly for the entire island. So we're taking samples for bacteria, archaea, fungi, and viruses, and also for microscopy to look at changes throughout the disease progression in hopes to hopefully potentially locate and identify the pathogenic agents. So our study site, their study sites are around Roatan in the Bay Islands of Honduras. We have a northern site off of this private island and one on the southern side of the island. And here in Roatan, this disease is causing extensive coral mortality. It first showed up there in fall 2020. And these sites were selected because they were a few of the remaining sites in the Caribbean, not just Roatan, that remained disease-free at the time of initial sampling. So we tried to get ahead of the disease front. So as I mentioned, the goal of this study is to identify which potentially pathogenic microbes are being affected by the application of the antibiotics and where these microbes are located within the coral tissue so that we could provide a more targeted approach to preventing and or treating this disease. So again, the goals to the research objectives are to sample and tag coral colonies from multiple species ahead of the disease outbreak, monitor and resample them after they show signs of disease, and then after they're treated with antibiotics, and then assess the bacterial and fungal community composition throughout disease progression and recovery, and finally use the microscopy to visualize changes to coral tissues and the microbial community structure throughout disease progression and recovery. So we initially sampled that first site in May 2021, but in August 2021, we went back and sampled that Oak Ridge southern site. Their colonies were visibly healthy with no observations of disease at the time. I think several months later, our partners there did see evidence of disease in the deeper part of the reef, which is interesting. That's usually where the disease shows up. We collected and preserved fragments for microbiology and microscopy. Our partners went back and sampled during an active infection for several colonies. Whenever they go back to survey the site every month or so, they survey which colonies are still remaining and which have been affected. And then if they're diseased, they'll apply the antibiotic paste and come back and revisit it again in several weeks' time to take another sample. And to see, then we can see which microbes the antibiotics might be knocking out. So here are a couple of our tagged colonies. Again, we've tagged them so we can revisit the same ones with these cattle tags so we can find them in the field. And as I mentioned, we sampled a fragment for molecular analysis to see what microbial community members are present, sampled for microscopy to see what the tissues look like. And then we also sampled for transmission electron microscopy so we can look for evidence of those viruses I talked about earlier inside of the symbionts. So this is a sort of graphic summary of the samples we have at the two sites. And already since last August, I think we've lost all of the Meandrioides. Maybe there might be one left. Several Coprophila natans have been infected. And so we're continuing to keep an eye on these and to work with our partners to determine what's going on here. And so I know we've been talking a lot about the microorganisms associated with disease, but corals themselves are, in fact, what we term holobionts. In fact, all living things are. We have many microbial associates, and in most cases, they're doing beneficial things for us. So it's a healthy part of the microbiome. In addition to the symbiodeniaceae, which we know about, the endosymbionts that live in the coral that provide food, there are also many bacteria that do beneficial things like cycle nutrients, control pathogens, and also play a role in coral larvae recruitment and settlement. Also, archaea might play a role in nitrogen cycling. You have those endolithic microbes, like algae and fungi that can be playing roles in UV protection, nutrient cycling. Viruses may control populations of bacteria and algae and take part in gene transfer for beneficial reasons. And then we're learning more about protists, there may be forming many symbioses with corals as well. And so as I mentioned, for some of the diseases, they're polymicrobial in nature. So we're kind of shifting away from this one pathogen, one disease, and in fact are looking at that maybe when corals become sick, and we also see this across many different animals, including humans, that you start out with sort of a stable, healthy microbiome, and then under some sort of stress, and in this diagram it's showing heat stress, you get an increase in microbial diversity and richness in these communities, and it leads to a dysbiotic microbiome. It's just kind of out of whack, right? And so the function changes. And then you start to see signs of disease, bleaching, and death. And so we think that that's what we might be seeing for a lot of these different diseases we're observing in corals. So in some cases, if that microbiome is not able to recover, it results in that dysbiosis and disease. But in some cases, it might actually provide the coral with resilience to disturbance. And in other cases, if you get a change in the microbiome, in a shift, it might infer some new adaptation to allow them to respond to climate change or other environmental disturbances. So in this same vein, scientists, several groups like Blake Ushijima's group and others have been looking at the use of probiotics to treat coral disease and bleaching, much like it can be used in humans after you've taken a course of antibiotics and disrupt your gut microbiome or whatnot, or eat yogurt with live strains of bacteria to restore your gut microbiome. And they've seen actually very promising signs in using probiotics to treat stony coral tissue loss disease as well. So it's kind of an emerging area of research and starting to change how we think about these systems. And in fact, we really do take more of a nested ecosystem concept approach, where we're looking at, you know, the environmental factors along with these microbiome interactions at both within an organism, between organisms, and between organisms in the surrounding environment and water column. So on that note, we are going to end on a lighter, more happier topic. And we're going to focus on this part of the microbiome and their role in the recruitment and settlement of coral babies. So this project is the role of microbial biofilms in coral settlement. Biofilms form essentially anytime you throw anything into the environment, especially an aquatic environment. So if you were to touch your teeth, but we won't do that because it's pandemic times, you have biofilms on your teeth full of microbes. And so we'll talk about their role in corals. This is a coral releasing gametes into the water. So many corals, actually the majority of corals, are broadcast spawners. They release sperm and eggs or sperm and egg bundles into the ocean during certain times of the year. And then what happens is they start to metamorphose into planula larvae. They look like tiny grains of rice. And in fact, in this one, you can see some of them, the symbionts are passed along from the parent to offspring. And then they do have mobility. They're carried with currents, but they do have mobility and can swim around. And so they swim around until they find an appropriate place to settle and metamorphose into an individual little polyp. And so you can see two individuals here, then they will continue to divide and form more polyps until they form a colony. So you can see this pinkish substance here is crustose coral and algae. And there's much known about that and that induces settlement. But the more we study these systems, we also find there's indeed a microbial component that plays a really important part in serving as a cue for settlement. What we don't know is the effects of the environment on the biofilms and then the downstream effects of those biofilm composition changes on larval recruitment. And so our lab is looking at this aspect to provide basic ecological information about coral settlement and reef succession, but also to provide guidance for coral restoration efforts as we start to sort of seed reefs or put them corals back out onto the reef. So for this project, we're surveying microbial composition of biofilms from two different sites on the north coast of Roatan over time. In addition, we're measuring different environmental conditions in those reef sites, like temperature, nutrients, salinity, even the surrounding seawater microbes, to see how they might impact or affect the composition of those biofilms. And then quantify the coral recruits to those biofilms to see who settles there. So this is some photos of us doing field work. There's Dr. Wood and myself putting out these settlement platforms, and we use these ceramic tiles so to mimic the calcium carbonate reef substrate. So the corals like to settle on this hard substrate. But the real star of the show is graduate student Jordan Sims. This is her PhD dissertation work, and that's her conducting a video survey of the reef site, so we have an idea of what adult corals are there that could be reproducing and either seeding the site or affecting settlement. And in fact, she just was awarded a prestigious National Science Foundation graduate research fellowship to carry out this work, and she's just been fantastic. She will now be recruiting her own recruits to process all of these samples when we finally get them back from Honduras. That's the only joke I have, sorry. So these are the settlement plates 1 month out. You can see they're kind of getting scrungy looking with some algae settling on them. This is months later in December. You can see they look much different. And I just am happy to say that when I brought these first to Honduras, these little garden tile slates my colleagues were looking at me like, these are not going to persist over the winter storm, but they are still there. Some of them did get knocked loose, but they are still there. So they survived. This is a very cost-efficient way to carry this out. But you can see there's a lot of algae here. And in fact, the corals like to settle on the underneath side. And I think that could be due to predation, maybe competition with algae, maybe light. But you can see here, there's one little coral baby right there, one polyp. And so that was very exciting to see. And oh, here's another one too. And as we start to peel these off and look at them, we'll start to document what microbes are here, what corals are here. Here's another one. You can see these are, this looks a little bit different from a different site. You have these worm tubes, but here's another different coral species, a polyp there. And so this is really exciting that we were able to see these recruits and gives us hope. So what happens after we collect these samples or collect these microbes in the field? Well, this is typically what it looks like. This is what we like to think that we're doing when we're collecting samples. It's very magical. And although we eventually sadly have to leave this beautiful tropical island, at least we get to come back here to this beautiful facility in Woodbridge, the Potomac Science Center. So my laboratory is on the third floor as part of the Potomac Environmental Research and Education Center. Again, on the third floor, my lab, the Salerno Laboratory of Integrative Microbial Ecology, or SLIME, which is aptly named because we indeed study slime. Thank you. There's my Twitter feed and our lab website if you want to check it out. And we have this beautiful view of a turtle pond where we watch turtles and muskrats swim around. It does no longer has this clean new lab smell. It's now populated with a lot of equipment and pipette tips, but this is what it looked like when we first moved in. But it's a fantastic place to work. So we use, how do we study microbes? We use molecular tools. There are many tools you can use, like microscopy and culturing. And in fact, we still use these, but alone, they can only tell you so much because there are only so many shapes, sizes, and colors of bacteria and microbes, right? So what the molecular tools allow us to do is to detect genetic differentiation. And I'll talk about this later, but it's even more powerful when you combine it with those other tools. So this is what our sampling schema looks like. We go out and say we take a fragment of a coral colony and we have our environmental sample, and we pull out all the DNA, not just from the bacteria, but also the coral host. And now we just want to isolate the bacterial DNA. So we make copies using something called polymerase chain reaction. You can think of it as like a genetic molecular photocopier. So I can pull out just the gene of interest, which is called the 16S ribosomal RNA gene. It's a gene marker for bacteria, and make copies of that so I have enough to work with. Then I take that and we use a DNA sequencing machine to read the genetic code, the A's, T's, C's, and G's. So you can go back and watch the first Jurassic Park to get your primer on DNA. It's fantastic. It's aged really well. And so we read the genetic code. We then take that code and match it to a reference library of known microorganisms, many of which are harbored at the ATCC across the street. That's why we have a lot of these references. And then through that, we can find out who's there and how many. You can take this a step further and sequence the entire, all of the genes of a sample and look at the potential function of what they're doing. You can look at the metatranscriptome of what genes are being expressed to see what's active. And you can even look at the proteins being expressed to see what they're producing. So as you can imagine, over time, in some of the studies I talked about, so in our apparently healthy versus diseased colonies, we can look at what shifts are going on. In our biofilms, we could see how these populations and ratios change over time. And because bacteria adapt so quickly and respond so quickly to environmental change, they're really good biological indicators of environmental disturbance. So it's a really useful tool. But it's even more useful when you can pair it with microscopy. And that's why I love working with Dr. Peters, and our lab groups have been working together to try to marry these two worlds by doing things like fluorescent in situ hybridization, where you can actually take a molecular probe specific to a specific taxa of bacteria, and it'll light up in your microscopy when you look under the microscope, and you can locate it within your sample. And then we have another student here, Eric Mazur, and what he's using is laser capture microdissection, which that special microscope is housed in the building next door, I think. And it's fantastic because you can actually go in and dissect out individual bacterial cells from the coral tissue. and sequence them and identify them, which is very powerful because otherwise, as I mentioned, what we do is take a sample, take a grab sample, grind it all up, and see what's there, and you lose any of the spatial organization of what's going on and where it's located. And we know how important it is to know where, for example, this the symbionts are located, right, in the coral. So, as to this, you know, even though we talk about all this death, disease, and destruction, I believe there still is hope for reefs. And all the work that scientists are doing to determine how reefs will respond to climate change and how we can effectively restore these ecosystems. I used to feel pretty skeptical, and I still don't think we can out-restore climate change, but I do think there are there's a lot of important and interesting work that can be done to restore reefs. And also, most importantly, education is a fantastic tool for conserving reefs. So I appreciate all of you coming out. I love doing public talks like this. And so you're here because you're interested and want to learn more about this. And then you can use your voice to spread this information to others, especially your local representatives, which you can call because they work for us. And so again, some of the restoration work, these are students in our class. And then this is a coral tree at the Roatan Institute for Marine Sciences, where they're outgrowing Acropora cervicornis and Acropora palmata corals, which in a previous disease outbreak, luckily these aren't as susceptible to stony coral tissue loss disease, but in the 80s and 90s, they were sort of wiped out due to another disease, and we're trying to restore these corals. But again, some of the most important tools are education, right? And so teaching students to be the next coral researchers, we have a lecture and lab and study abroad component, coral reef ecology class. Every year we've been trying to, and this year we finally will be bringing our students down to Roatan next month, where they can learn how to carry out and conduct underwater surveys, learn the different coral and fish species. And it's a fantastic program. We've also received very generous funding from our study abroad office that provides scholarships for students to partake in that. And so the other initiative I've launched with several of my colleagues at Mason, and as Dr. Leota mentioned, I've actually spent some time working on Capitol Hill and at the State Department. And so it's so important for students to learn how to translate science in a way to policymakers in a way that's understandable and useful, so that work can be translated into effective policy. And so we have established and developed and are implementing a science policy minor and a graduate certificate for STEM students here. And we launched our first class last fall, and we had our students create informational one-pagers, policy briefs that they presented to Senator Kaine's office and other members of Congress. And so that's something that we hope to continue. And so finally, I think my major inspiration and reason for hope are certainly our students. They're just so eager, ambitious, passionate. And so both mine and Esther's graduate students, our SLIME members here, have been working so hard, and it's been wonderful to see how innovative they've been over the course of the pandemic, and honestly, how supportive they've been of one another. So I don't have everyone up here, so I want to thank all the current and past SLIME members for all of your support and help to help our lab grow and to continue this work. And so with that, I will end the presentation. Thank you all, and take any questions you may have.